Hello and welcome to My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll. I'm Peter Noon. In today's show, I'll be joined by... He's directed some of the earliest music videos and rock films, including Let It Be for the Beatles, director Michael Lindsay Hogg. He rose to video notoriety with his clip for Wicked Game, and his current album is San Francisco Days, Chris Isaak. Each of his first seven singles reached the top five, and he sold over 15 million records worldwide. Richard Marx. Grammy Award-winning record producer and member of the group Was Not Was, Dom Was. And later in our show, we'll be joined via satellite by Todd Rundgren. So we'll be starting off the show exactly where we finished the last show, talking about music videos, only now at the beginning of a new era, the 80s.
Four, we've gone for main engine start. We have main engine
start. Ladies and gentlemen, rock and roll.
This is it. Welcome to MTV Music Television, the world's first 24-hour stereo video music channel. Now, starting right now, you'll never look at music the same way again.
Video killed the radio star. 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 Video killed the radio.
So, Chris, that was a pretty prophetic or pathetic statement by Mark Goodman. What do you think of that?
I didn't know. I thought he was the guy who sold that music late at night. And now I remember he was on there.
So, Michael, what exactly are videos? Are they commercials for records, or are they artistic statements?
I think they're both. I think they've become more commercials for records, because I think, like we were saying before, I mean, MTV has changed so much since it started in the last 5, 6, 7 years. It's changed so much. But I also think, as far as the performer is concerned, that although they want to sell records, but they don't want to think they're doing some piece of crap. I mean, they want to do something which is interesting for them to take part in, and how they spend their time and what the concept is. So I think they can be both. The trouble is, a lot of the imagery has been so used and reused and reused again that it doesn't have much vibrancy anymore. Mm-hmm. I think, but it we're in part of. I mean, that's probably what Todd Rundgren is also going to come and talk to us about. Is that things are changing so much and so fast? You know, as you go into this, you know, I mean, there are people alive who were born, you know, before there were airplanes, let alone people landing on the moon. I mean, if you think of the century we're in, who knows what's going to happen? I mean, it's very hard to think of music now being detached from images. But like, I like Los Lobos, and I don't see them on MTV very much, but I listen to the music a lot. You know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They have been on MTV, I think that's right.
Yeah, they have, but I mean, they're not in heavy rotation.
Yeah, they don't have a Los Lobos weekend.
Yeah, they should.
Which I propose starting right now. Yeah. Yeah. You get a Los Lobos weekend.
So did any music videos ever actually destroy an act or harm their career? Like Springsteen maybe for a while there?
No, I don't think so.
No?
They might
Anyone?
Come back. You know, you know what's funny is that once they have a video of you and, like, looking really ridiculous, and you're right in, you know, bell bottoms and you got your hair just the right way, and then 10 years later that's the worst thing in the world. I mean, then they come back and play at heavy rotation of you looking totally out of style. So that way it can come around.
I think it can kill a record. I mean, I've actually... Yeah, I've been one of those bands that been on Top of the Pops and the record went down the next week because, you know, they thought it was a bunch of young kids up to playing, and then here come these rats from Detroit and the record drops. You know, it's,
rats from Detroit, you're tough on yourself, my friend. Come on, man. You're a good-looking fellow.
I know a band who, when they're in the studio creating the song and they start in the beginnings of the song, they go, I can see the video now. We're on a beach in Brazil. Mm. There are beautiful women all around us. And they start to change the...
Well, that's probably the most honest use of the art form, you know, rather than something that completely corrupts a great song. At least, I think that's where the best videos probably came from, is where you leave a little room so that, you know, to me, if you make a good record, it's an audio record, you've told the listener everything you want to tell them. You leave just enough to the imagination, and that's why it works. So in that sense, videos become, you know, some growth on top of this perfect being, you know. But if you leave a little room in there or incorporate the video in the act of creation, that's probably where the highest quality stuff comes from.
Right. Richard, when you're making the single, when you're making the record, I mean, when you're making the record, do you think, ooh, I can see this video Never. Coming along?
Well, you know what I really, okay. You know what I love about making videos? Mm-hmm. Nothing.
Oh, really?
I'm just, I wish I enjoyed it, and I've made a few videos that I'm proud of, but I don't find it a very creative thing for me. I like writing songs and playing with a band and making records and being in the studio. To me, that's very creative, and video making, for the most part, is sitting around waiting for guys to light things. And yeah. It's just sort of not really, doesn't do anything for me. I mean, I'm proud of some of the results and my input in the videos, but no, I just write songs, you know what I mean? I just write songs that I like, and I guess maybe I should pay more attention to videos, because I've seen good records with unbelievably adventurous and thought-provoking videos that just go crazy.
Right.
But I just guess I don't, I just, I'd rather, my favorite video would be sitting here playing, looking at the camera and performing. I mean, to me, that's
where they all start.
I want it to be all about the song, right. And the video is sort of an afterthought for me.
Chris,
well, then maybe at the end you'd burst into flames.
That would be good.
Huh?
That would be good.
Maybe I watch too much MTV. Maybe then you burst into flames and then there'd be a girl dancing kind of naked.
Kind of naked.
Come across, you know, not really naked because it's, you know, it's MTV.
But is that what, hey, this sounds like one of your videos. This could be your, I mean, when you're creating the song, do you think of the video or is that?
I think,
is that somebody
else's
idea? When
I write songs, I got a pretty good vision of what it's about. And the better the song I write, the more strong a vision I have. Then usually I don't have enough money to do that. You know, it's like, so it ends up being some other kind of short form.
Okay, Michael, what they really mean is that if they could make videos and direct them themselves.
Oh, sure. I remember I did a video with Artie Garfunkel, which was the non-video of all time, which was him, I forget the song, him sitting in a chair reading a book. And that was it, one shot. The label wouldn't put it out, though. We loved it. Because we thought the idea was that then who's ever watching it, after a while, when they realize that's all they're going to get for their money, is that then we'll start to think about the song
or something else.
Exactly. And it was just one shot. It's like some German expressionist movie, just already sitting reading a book. Whatever book he's reading, he brought out of his pocket. He had his beret on. That was it. But the label wouldn't
get behind it. I wonder why. How could they not get behind that? Marvin reading a book?
I don't know why.
Heavy rotation, boy. I'll pull him off the air. Sure, you got all your naked chicks. I got a guy reading a book. The public wants.
We have to take a short break. We'll be right back with more of My Generation's roundtable discussion on music video.
Maybe he reads a book and at the end he bursts into flames. Virtual reality of a rock band in your house, you know, your kids are asleep and it's like 2 in the morning. I don't know.
Welcome back to My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll, where our current topic of discussion is the music video. I'm Peter Noon with my guests Michael Lindsay Hogg, Chris Isaak, Richard Marx, and Dom Woz. And before we go any further, let's look at what's happening right now in video, in the 90s.
We switched round and round till half past dawn. There was 57 channels and nothing on. 57 channels and nothing on. 57 channels and nothing on.
Is it arch or is it pornography?
Well, I think after watching that segment, I think all those videos reflect the same thing, that the quantity of the information has outpaced the quality of the information. Before we discuss that, I'd like to introduce, via satellite, our guest. He's a multi-talented performer. He has a new CD out called No World Order. Here he is, Todd Rundgren. How you doing,
Hello.
Todd?
How you doing?
Are you up in a satellite or what?
That's exactly.
All right. You look very nice up there.
Satellite of love.
Hey, Todd. What do you see as far as the future for music video in the 90s?
Well, I don't see that the form has evolved so quickly in the past that we can expect it to be completely different in the 90s. there is still a fair degree of diversity. Certainly Michael Jackson's videos have this kind of Hollywood quality, and as opposed to that, there might be the information overload style of YouTube videos. So I don't think you can single out a direction. I think that the more significant change is the ability of the audience to sort of talk back to the delivery system in a way, and maybe get a little bit more of what they would prefer to see rather than a program or director's idea of what good video is.
Richard, you've seen the Peter Gabriel, you know, computer-generated technology, the Peter Gabriel Steam video. Have you seen that one?
I've seen the Steam. I think maybe they were talking about Kiss the Frog, mm-hmm. which is the latest video, I think, which is almost like a ride.
It's one of these so-called motion platform rides. I've been to the company that that essentially co-developed it, and it's a company called iWorks, and they make these things that are like Star Tours. I don't know if you've ever been in that in Disneyland. Essentially, you sit in a seat, and the seat moves around, so it gives you a greater sensory input, but it's not really interactive. You can't determine the scenario yourself. You just kind of go along for the ride.
Chris, how do you think this is going to affect music videos? Do you want to do a video where people go for a ride?
Todd, is it like Nintendo?
Yeah, you get big blisters on your thumbs.
You gotta put it in more simple terms for me, Todd, baby. Is it like Nintendo or is it like Pong? I don't know.
It's a Super Mario thing,
I just played Nintendo the first time, and hey, amazing. Yeah. I don't know. I have no idea about this kind of stuff. I don't get it. It's like, look, they don't let me push a wheelbarrow. I'm not allowed to build your machinery there.
But perhaps Michael knows something about it. What's going to happen with
this stuff? No, unfortunately not. I'm more with you this time. It's difficult for me to figure out how it's going to... I see how someone feeling they're taking part in something is going to be nice and interesting for them. To do with the thing itself, if it makes the work, either its commercial aspects or its artistic ones better, I don't know. That's the puzzle to me.
Plus, do you want to have, you want to have like some, kind of rock band actually coming into your house? Do you mean actually that virtual reality of a rock band in your house, your kids are asleep and it's like 2 a.m? I don't know.
Obviously, this isn't a fad. I mean, if you think there's always been fads in entertainment, there's been 3D, there's been smell-o-vision, whatever the hell it's been. This is obviously not a fad because it's due with the whole change in communications which is going on as we move toward the next century. I don't know what it's going to do to the thing, because what we've been talking about, because Todd, before you came on, I mean, we were talking about, where this all started and Elvis Presley and some guy getting up there and singing the song that he wrote and some kind of raw human being on the stage, and that's where rock and roll started as. And now it's gone on to such sophisticated levels, I don't know where the original little bit of dirt, which makes the oyster, what makes the pearl, what pearl it's going to be.
That's the exciting thing about it, though.
Is that so far it's been the province of technical people and business people who've invested in it. But as it turns now back to artists, it's a wide open field. It's like making films in 1900. Artists can make anything of this that they want to. The great thing is finding the emotional impulse that makes for a great song or a great film or whatever, and using this medium, define the medium. That's what's thrilling about it. Todd did something, he's the first to do it. There's no means of comparison. It's the last frontier in this thing.
Well, I think that, that the sort of apprehension you feel about learning new things is something that, some people feel apprehensive about technology and just have a natural tendency to shy away from it, even though it may not be as complicated as it seems to them. And so if the new technology is going to become a valid tool for artists to express themselves in, they're going to have to understand, in the same way that the first time you pick up a guitar, you don't know how to make a G minor seventh chord or anything like that. You're going to have to invest a little bit of effort into learning some of these new things, but the rewards in the long run are that you can have a greater degree of control over the process and add new dimensions to the ways that you express yourself.
Just another technical question. The reason you can't see us is because you're on satellite, or is it because you're wearing glasses?
That's it.
Oh.
Oh, is that what's wrong?
That's it.
Okay, I'm going to have to take a short break, but we'll be right back with more of My Generation's Roundtable discussion on the music video. We'll be right back.
we have to realize, you know, that as artists, musicians and the legacy of popular music is not necessarily to make great, huge, grand statements. As a matter of fact, it's often so much just to get laid that we're really trying to create impressions of ourselves that don't exist.
Peter Noon back with you on My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll. Here I am with my special guests, Michael Lindsay Hogg, Chris Isaak, Richard Marx, Don Was, and via satellite, Todd Rundgren. Hey, Todd, just for Chris Isaak and I, would you tell us a little bit about interactive audio?
Interactive music?
While you're at it, Todd, also I'd like to know about the thing on the VCR. I got one, it's not a good one. I think it's the Eagle brand, but it says it's got like the day and the date.
Yeah.
And it's always flashing. How do you...
Always flashing. Always 12 o'clock,
that.
Right?
Yeah.
It's always 12, right?
Not at your house, I'm betting. Huh? I bet yours says whatever day, right?
Yeah, whatever. Whatever day it is, it's okay.
Amazing. Yeah.
What was the question?
We were talking about interactive.
Oh, yeah. Don't wait for the
music.
Translation, Senator.
Interactive music, yeah.
Okay. Interactive music.
Well, music has always been traditionally a linear form. In other words, it always has this very strict agenda. It starts in one place and ends in another place. Of course, jazz may not conform to that definition, but for the most part, it's something where the audience is really passive the whole time. And there are other art forms in which the agenda is determined a little bit more by the audience. For instance, if you go to a museum to look at some painting or sculpture, nobody says you can only look at it for 2 minutes. And you can only look at it from this particular angle. You have some control over the way you experience it. And the idea is to make music something in which the audience has a little bit more control of the experience. So the idea of interactive music is to allow the music to conform to a greater number of situations.
Don, if we get this interactive CD, can we like get rid of the drummer and then get rid of the singer and then we can put the first verse at the end and stuff like that?
That's actually exactly what you can do.
You can get rid of the drummer.
Basically, he's broken his album down into segments of where you can take the first verse of a song and tack it onto the chorus of the eighth song on the album. Maybe never ever listen to the third song on the album. You can choose different versions with you know, strip it down to where it's only drums and bass and vocal, or versions of the
remix
songs.
Remix it yourself.
To a limited degree, yeah.
So Richard, listening to all this, what do you think is the future? Like 10 years from now, when you watch VH1 and MTV, what do you think we're likely to see in videos?
God only knows.
Hopefully, lots of yours.
Yeah, always. Hopefully, lots of whoever's you're talking to. I don't know. I'm fascinated by the technology. I'm impressed with what we're able to do, but it really, for me, so far at this stage of the game, hasn't entered into the way I create music. It hasn't. I mean, and for me, you know, I don't think I'd really want anybody to be able to put the first verse of a song at the end of another one, and because that's the only thing I do feel like I have some control over in my whole life. Is what I put on a record.
Well, that's the thing, because when Todd was talking earlier about when you go to an art gallery and you see a painting, the painter thought, well, that's the way I like it best. I like that little bit of blue up there, and I like the face of it, like Van Gogh. I like the green eyes, whatever the hell he did. This is what I like best. And what's really interesting, because Todd's explaining it very, very well, it has to be in its infancy, this whole movement of what's going to happen, because at the moment, I sort of side with Richard. I like it to be what I think is right, and then if someone else wants another way, let him go and do it himself.
I've been making music for 25 years, and I spent probably the greater portion of that, you know, having the same, pretty much the same attitude as everyone else, which is, you know, this is a very precious thing, you know, has to be exactly this way, and if I had the power to do it, I would have gone into people's homes and adjusted their stereos so that they would have gotten exactly the right spectral balance on everything, and sat them down and say, listen to this part, it's really good, you know, this kind of stuff. And we have to realize, you know, that as artists, musicians and the legacy of popular music is not necessarily to make great, huge, grand statements. As a matter of fact, it's often so much just to get laid that we're really trying to create impressions of ourselves that don't exist. And in that sense, I've gotten to the point in my life where that's not useful to me anymore. And I just assume people know exactly what I'm doing in all of its aspects, you know?
It's very exciting, but it is something completely new. I mean, I want to have a go. I mean, I'm interested in now having a go with your record and see what I can do to it, you know? I mean,
Smoke, fire, good-looking women. Those three things are going to be in every video forever. Mark my words, kids.
Oh, I thought you said that you had to smoke, light a fire.
Good-looking women. They're going to be in all videos.
All right. Well, I'm afraid we've run out of time, so don't forget to come and watch us again on My Generation's Roundtable History of Rock and Roll when we all talk about videos of the 60s, 70s, and 80s. Thanks for watching My Generation. Bye. Grammy award-winning record producer and a member of the group Was Not Was, Don Was. And later in our show, we'll be joined by satellite with Rod. Via satellite.
Would you get it right? Once again, Don Was.
Okay, here we go. Grammy Award winning record producer and member of the group Was Not Was, Don Was. And later in our show, we'll be joined via satellite by Todd Grundgren.
Give me this, Jesus Christ.
Todd Grundgren. Oh, Jesus. Rundgren.
Just move your mouth a little bit and add the words in.
Thank you. Loop me.
How do they get Mr. Ed to do it? With peanut butter, isn't it?
Strings.